Par excellence presents Jewels from the Holy Quran, a series of lectures by Mufti Ismail ibn Musa Menk.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عباده الذين اصطفى. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including Moses and Aaron, may peace be upon them, and Jesus Christ, may peace be upon him as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst them who can be truly followers of these messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and sisters, and dearest listeners, we indeed need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us the fact that we have abstained from food and drink, and we have fasted for his sake, and the fact that we have stood up in Salat al-Taraweeh for his sake. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really accept that from us, and may he grant us the spiritual upliftment that is required for ourselves, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us more conscious of those who are needy around us, and may he grant us the ability to reach out to them at all times. Ameen. Tonight's verses, we commenced with Surah Al-A'raf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the previous nations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us what they did, what the messengers said who were sent to them, and what was the outcome. And the lesson is for all of us, because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent messengers with messages to those before us, and when they belied the messengers, they were then punished, we would be foolish to think that if we had to belie the message of the messengers, we would not be punished. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all understanding. So he starts off by mentioning the issue of Satan, Iblis, alayhi la'natullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of Shaytan, and he says, when we created you, we ordered the angels to prostrate to you. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ صَوَّرْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ لَمْ يَكُنْ مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ. We created you, we gave you your shape, and we asked, after having created you, we asked the angels to prostrate to you. They all prostrated besides the devil, besides Iblis. Now one might ask, was Iblis from amongst the angels? The answer was no. He was not from amongst the angels, but he had lots of good deeds, so he was considered as one of the good ones. But then he showed his true colors here when he refused to acknowledge the virtue that was given to man by the Creator himself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us, as he warned Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, be careful of this devil. He has promised that he is going to lead you astray, and I am going to give him time, because I would like to reward those who still obey me, knowing that the evil is all the plan of the devil. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has creatures, angels. The angels do not have the ability to disobey. They were all very truthful, and they obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's commands, and up to this moment they obey the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on the other hand, there is the creature known as the devil or shaitan, Satan, Iblis and his progeny. Now they don't have the ability to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they had to obey, we would have solved the problem, or the problem would have been solved. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created man in the middle. Man is able to sin and to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants man to use the intellect that Allah has given him to remain steadfast on the path. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wherever you have fallen, I'd like you to turn to me. Because that act of tawbah, no other creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's, meaning from the two that we've mentioned, engages in it. So insan engages in it, and that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam and Hawa alayhim as-salam in heaven, in paradise, in Jannah. And they were then prohibited from a certain tree. After having eaten from that tree, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then waited for something. Before he threw them onto the earth, there was something that was required. Why didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala automatically throw Adam and Hawa alayhim as-salam into the earth or onto the earth as soon as they committed the sin? No, He gave them some time to teach us something. What was that? Listen to what the Quran says.
قَالَا رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ
The two of them said, O our Rabb, O our Creator, we have wronged ourselves. We have committed a sin. We have oppressed ourselves. If you don't have mercy on us and if you don't forgive us, we will be from amongst the losers. So forgive us. That is when Allah says, I have forgiven you, but now you can go onto the earth. So that we would be taught that wherever we falter, we need to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as He decrees in tonight's verses that we read.
وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ
My mercy encompasses everything. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He has to have mercy on all His creatures, it would not be equivalent to that amount of His mercy that He has, that a pin, if dropped into the oceans, would displace an amount of water. Even that amount of water is not equivalent to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after having had mercy upon all His creatures. So imagine if He had to show us all His mercy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all mercy. In fact, one day the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were passing by a woman who was breastfeeding, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked them, do you think that this woman who is breastfeeding her baby can throw that baby into the fire? And they said, no ways, that is impossible. This woman is cuddling this child and the woman is breastfeeding the baby. It is impossible for this woman to throw the baby into the fire because of the mercy of the woman on her child. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I would like every one of you to know that the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is far greater than the highest amount of mercy that this woman can ever show towards this child of hers. So we need to understand. Let's give the Almighty one excuse to forgive us, and inshallah we will be forgiven. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us on the straight path and always grant us the hope that is required to turn to Him. So after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how the devil had turned Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, and how Adam alayhi salatu wasalam sought forgiveness, how he was forgiven, and then he was sent onto the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses all of us. And He says,
يَا بَنِي آدَمَ لَا يَفْتِنَنَّكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ كَمَا أَخْرَجَ أَبَوَيْكُمْ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ يَنْزِعُ عَنْهُمَا لِبَاسَهُمَا لِيُرِيَهُمَا سَوْآتِهِمَا
O children of Adam, don't let the same Satan and devil lead you astray, and don't let him plan and plot against you successfully in the same way that he planned and plotted against your forefather Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the dress code. Why does He speak about the dress code thereafter? Because it was at that point that Adam and Hawa alayhim as-salam, their shame began to appear, meaning their private parts began to appear and they felt ashamed. So they drew from the leaves of Jannah and paradise and they began to cover themselves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we have created for you clothing. So when should we be dressing up? That's a question. Obviously here we are addressing more the males than the females. I will get to the females just now inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
يَا بَنِي آدَمَ خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفِينَ
O children of Adam, when you are coming to my house, meaning the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the masajid, places of worship, then you should make sure that you are dressed appropriately, you are smelling good, and you have adorned yourself in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires. We shouldn't be pitching up at the masjid in our PJs, so to speak. We shouldn't be coming for Salatul Fajr in clothes that are tatty and torn, that we would not like to meet someone with. You know, when you have an appointment with a president, You would probably buy a suit 1 month in advance. Make sure that it's properly tailored and everything is neat and smart. Buy the best scent and dress up well in advance. 30 minutes before your appointment, you arrive at the president's palace because you know I've got a very important meeting. What about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Lord of the worlds, creator of universe. When we come to him, we come in our pajamas. Is that fair? May Allah make us conscious, more conscious of that. We should be dressing properly and we should come to the masjid for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we get to the women folk. The women folk are meant to be dressing for their husbands. And when they are in the house, they are meant to be dressed very, very well so that that husband does not need to look anywhere else. But today they do the opposite. Or not they, but some of them. May Allah protect us all. When they are leaving the house, suddenly that's when the lipstick comes out and the dressing comes up and the good scents come up. And when they walk out of the house, for every other man to see. But when they come into the house, that is when everything comes off again and smelling of food all day. May Allah protect us all. We know it's the month of Ramadan, but we need to make sure that when husband comes home, we must be dressed. Then inshallah, we won't be complaining of a bitter marriage. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. It's common sense, but sometimes we become oblivious of it. So the reminders are here in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells that to us. Otherwise, when going out, the women folk are meant to be dressing very, very modestly. As I said, the Islam has not told you exactly what to dress with, but Islam has presented a framework and said you must stay within that framework. Dress modestly when you go out. Don't go out to show others. وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَىٰ. Don't dress in order to attract the attention of others, like what the people of the previous nations used to do. In fact, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all, and may he grant us the power to dress properly, and may he be pleased with us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how the people of paradise and the people of hellfire will be talking to one another. They will be asking each other questions. Do you know, every evening we sit and we listen to verses. Those who do good deeds, those who are good, those who help others, those who do not harm other human beings, those who remove malice and jealousy, those who remove hatred and ill feeling, those who do not deceive and cheat, those who pray, those who fulfill their prayers and fast and so on and fulfill their duties. Allah says, you will get paradise. And those who are astray, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be warned of hell. Not always does he say you will enter hellfire, because he knows and he has mentioned there that those who engage in tawbah, those who seek forgiveness and repent, their bad deeds will actually be converted into good deeds on the right hand side of the scale. So when they come on the day of qiyamah, when they come on the day of judgment, after having committed so much wrong, but they had repented, they will say, well, I didn't do all these good deeds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, La ظُلْمَ الْيَوْمِ. There is no oppression on this day. I promised you that I would convert it for you if you turned. So let us all turn, inshallah. Let us all turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that at least he can grant us Jannah. Then when we get to Jannah now, when we get to paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there will be a discussion between the parties. One party on this side who's in paradise and the other in hell. Firstly, the people in Jannah and Paradise will ask a question to those in hell. وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ أَنْ قَدْ وَجَدْنَا مَا وَعَدَنَا رَبُّنَا حَقًّا فَهَلْ وَجَدْتُمْ مَا وَعَدَ رَبُّكُمْ حَقًّا قَالُوا نَعَمْ. They will call out. The people of Jannah will call out to the people of Jahannam. Hey, people of Jahannam, people of hell. We have found what our Lord has promised us to be the truth. Did you find what he promised you to be the truth? And they will very silently say, yes, we did. Yes, we did. Meaning they are in the punishment. May Allah protect us all. And may Allah safeguard the ummah. So they will say, yes, we did. And a caller will call out, curse be upon those who were astray. Curse be upon them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Then there will be a call from the people of the fire. وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ أَصْحَابَ الْجَنَّةِ أَنْ أَفِيضُوا عَلَيْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ أَوْ مِمَّا رَزَقَكُمُ اللَّهِ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَهُمَا عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. The people of Jahannam will call out to the people of Jannah, O people of paradise, can you pour on us some water so that the heat of this punishment can actually be lessened, the heat can drop? Or can you pour on us any liquid, any goodness that Allah has given you? And they will call out to say, definitely Allah has made that prohibited upon you today. We are not allowed to do that. It's prohibited for us and prohibited for you.
الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا دِينَهُمْ لَهُوًا وَلَعِبًا وَغَرَّتْهُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا فَالْيَوْمَ نَنْسَاهُمْ كَمَا نَسُوا لِقَاءَ يَوْمِهِمْ هَذَا.
Those who took their religion as a joke, as a mock, the laws and commands of their creator were flaunted and they did not take them seriously. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who forgot us on that day, we will forget them. Remember, it's never too late to repent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy is open. Inna Allah yaqbilu tawbat al-abdi ma lam yugharghir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stretches his hand of mercy every evening to forgive those who've committed sin by day. And he stretches the hand of forgiveness every day to forgive those who've committed sin by night. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. Until the point of gharghara, which is the point of sakarat, the point of death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not let death overtake us in a manner that we have not repented to him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after that makes mention of the previous nations. As we said, al-a'raf. A'raf meaning the heights or the walls or even the landmarks. Why the landmarks? Because if you go on earth, you'll be able to see some of the signs of the remains of the previous nations. Go to Egypt, you'll see the pyramids. Go to Madain Salih, Petra and so on, you'll see the remains of those nations. Allah says, those are landmarks, we've left them there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson from that. So Allah says regarding, firstly, Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam, Noah, may peace be upon him. When he came to his people, they were amazed. Now every time the stories of the prophets are repeated in the Quran, they are repeated for a different reason, not for the same reason. Sometimes there might be a bit of repetition of some of the facts, but each time it is there to highlight something different. Like in here, it is there to highlight the surprise, the amazement, the astonishment of the people when Allah sends a man to them. They were expecting an angel, or they were expecting something super to come to them. They were expecting a book to drop for them from heaven, just to drop. They were expecting other signs, and they said, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in fact makes mention of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed them by. Awa'ajibetum, are you surprised? Are you amazed? Are you amused? Are you astonished at the fact that
anja'akum dhikrum min rabbikum ala rajulin minkum liyunzirakum,
that we sent the message to you through a man from amongst you to warn you. So are you amazed? Do you know, we need to ask ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates from amongst us people who hold the message of truth, who come to us and remind us, listen, don't cheat others, don't deceive others, don't steal, don't lie, don't be bad, be a good person. Try and speak correctly, fulfill your duties and stay away from prohibitions. But sometimes we also turn a blind eye to such people. Sometimes we make life difficult for them. If that's the case, surely we should be learning from verses like these that those who made life difficult for the messengers were actually punished at some point if they didn't turn. So if we don't turn, do we think that the punishment of the Creator will not befall us? So we need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the others. Ad, Hud alayhi salatu wasalam, his nation was called Ad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the same thing. Awa ajibetum anja'akum dhikrum min rabbikum ala rajulin minkum liyunzirakum. Are you amazed at the fact that we have sent to you from amongst you a man to remind you and to warn you? Don't be amazed. Allah says, وَذْكُرُوا, remember, Allah is telling the second nation, remember,
إِذْ جَعَلَكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ مِنْ بَعْدِ قَوْمِ نُوحٍ وَزَادَكُمْ فِي الْخَلْقِ بَسْطَةً.
We have made you follow a nation whom we've already destroyed and we've granted you virtue slightly more than them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to remind the next nation to say, look at those we've destroyed before you and take heed. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them as well, or some of them, those who did not turn from amongst them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the next nation. the nation of Thamud. Salih alayhi salatu was salam in Madian, he told his people the same thing. And in fact, he went even further. And he turned away at one point after having reminded them for so long.
فَتَوَلَّى عَنْهُمْ وَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ لَقَدْ أَبْلَغْتُكُمْ رِسَالَةَ رَبِّي وَنَصَحْتُ لَكُمْ وَلَكِنْ لَا تُحِبُّونَ النَّاصِحِينَ.
O my people, I am now turning away. I have delivered the message. I have conveyed the message of my Creator to you. And I have given you good advice, but you don't like people who give you good advice. That's what he said. Then he went away and Allah says, we shook them. We had an earthquake to eat them up. And they were eaten. And those Madayan Salih in northern Saudi Arabia and southern Jordan, you will find the place of Salih alayhi salatu wasalam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. All these prophets made mention of the good advice. Ana lakum nasihun amin. Wa ansahu lakum. I am giving you good advice. Listen to me. Is what I am saying reasonable or not? It is reasonable. So listen to it and take heed. Don't continue in your bad ways and habits. In fact, the story is that of Lut alayhi salatu wasalam. Lot, may peace be upon him. Allah says he warned his people about sodomy and about homosexuality, but they didn't listen. They didn't take heed until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned them upside down and punished them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Shu'aib alayhi salatu wasalam. The same thing. In fact, he too, after some time, warning his people,
فَتَوَلَّى عَنْهُمْ وَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ لَقَدْ أَبْلَغْتُكُمْ رِسَالَاتِ رَبِّي وَنَصَحْتُ لَكُمْ فَكَيْفَ آسَى عَلَى قَوْمٍ كَافِرِينَ.
He turned away after some time, telling his people, oh my people, I have delivered the message of the Creator to you, and I have warned you, and I have given you good advice. Now, how do you want me to regret when punishment comes to you after I've warned you of that punishment? Imagine when a messenger comes and says, listen, there is punishment coming. And people know he's a messenger. And he's warned them 20 times, 50 times, and countless times. They still don't turn. Then when he walks away and goes away with the few who have followed him, do you think he can regret now when the punishment is descending on his people? When he has already warned them, still the messengers felt it. Because they didn't want their people to be punished. Who wants any human being to be punished? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard all of us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the towns and the people of the towns. And the lesson is for all of us.
أَفَأَمِنَ أَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ أَن يَأْتِيَهُمْ بَأْسُنَا بَيَاتًا وَهُمْ نَائِمُونَ أَوَأَمِنَ أَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ أَن يَأْتِيَهُمْ بَأْسُنَا ضُحًا وَهُمْ يَلْعَبُونَ.
Do the people of the towns feel secure and safe from a punishment that may overtake them at night whilst they are sleeping? Take a look at some of the floods, some of the earthquakes, some of the tremors that have taken place in our times. When did they happen? You hear stories of people and you read stories of people who perished in their sleep. Allah says, do we all feel safe and secure from the punishment that might overtake us at night whilst we are asleep? Or do the people of the towns feel secure and safe from a punishment that might overtake them during the daytime whilst they are playing in oblivion? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us all. Remember, this punishment is for those who are evil. And as I have mentioned many times in the past, let me repeat it here today again. When there is something, say an earthquake, say a tremor, say a flood, there are two types of people, or a few types of people. For one type of people, it might be a punishment. Those are those who are engaged in evil deeds. For them, it's a punishment. And those who were martyred in that same flood whilst engaging in a good deed, for them, it was a point of goodness. It was a good death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Take a look at the tsunami that took place in Indonesia some time back. Those who died whilst drinking and dancing and partying, for them it was punishment. But what about those who died in the masajid whilst in the condition of sujood? For them it was the best death possible. Allahu Akbar. So the same item can be a punishment for some. The same occurrence can be an act of goodness for others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all and grant us the understanding. It's a deep statement. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. Moses, may peace be upon him. And the story is quite long. But inshallah, we will go through the details of this story at a later stage, because it is the most repeated story in the Quran. The story of Moses and how his people harassed him, and how his people, some of them accepted and some of them didn't. And those who didn't, how they questioned him and how they battled with him and so on. And how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed Fir'aun, Pharaoh and his people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of what I spoke of last night, that they told Musa alayhi salatu wa salam, "O Moses, these plagues that have come to us in the form of frogs, in the form of disease, in the form of locusts and so on, that took over, that took place from time to time. If you, O Moses, get help for us from your Creator and remove all this, we will definitely follow you and we will send Banu Israel, the children of Israel, with you." So Musa alayhi salatu wa salam made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and definitely it was all lifted by the power of Allah. And after it was lifted, they reneged, they turned back. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of what they said. لَإِن كَشَفْتَ عَنَّا الرِّجْزَ لَنُؤْمِنَنَّ لَكَ وَلَنُرْسِلَنَّ مَعَكَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. If all this can be taken away from us, the evil that has befallen us can be taken away from us, then we will follow you and we will send with you the people of Israel, or the children of Israel. And Allah says,
فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُمُ الرِّجْزَ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ هُمْ بَالِغُوهُ إِذَا هُمْ يَنْكُثُونَ.
When we took away all the evil that befell them, then suddenly they reneged, they turned away, they forgot what they had promised us. Aren't we guilty sometimes of doing that? When we need something, we're in a problem, we've got a court case coming, we've got something happening, we've got a robbery that might have occurred, or something evil, a loss that we might have suffered, and we raise our hands and say, oh Allah, I promise you I'll be a very good person. Please grant me success in this examination that is there. If I get all A's, then this and that, and things of this nature. And if I pass, then this, and if this happens, then that, inshallah. And then when all that happens, we carry on as though we'd never made the dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If that's the case, we need to take a lesson from what happened at the time of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah says, after some time, when they kept on breaking their promises, then we decided to destroy them. And we all know how Pharaoh and his cronies were destroyed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So that is a very, very important point. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about a type of people whom He saves. If you recall, we spoke about how when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to destroy people, sometimes He gives them a lot of sustenance. We mentioned that yesterday. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, if you'd like to be saved from the punishment when it comes to the whole nation, then there is a way of doing that. What is the way? Allah says,
فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ أَنْجَيْنَا الَّذِينَ يَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ السُّوءِ.
When the people forgot us, and when they transgressed and they turned away to the degree that they now deserved the punishment, we first saved a certain group of people who used to remind others about the goodness and prohibit evil. So if you go around telling people, listen brother, this is wrong. Listen brother, this is incorrect. Listen my dear sister, don't do this. Even if people hate you as a result, you'll be earning the pleasure of the Almighty. When the punishment comes, it won't overtake you. Everyone might perish, but you will survive. There is a possibility. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the ability to put an end to what is wrong, or to try at least to speak by tongue. Sometimes we know people, friends of ours, community members, influential people, non-influential people, oppressing people whom we know, but we don't even have the courage to tell them, listen brother, please don't do this. It's wrong. It's haram. Don't do this. Even that small statement will be a cause of our savior, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then speaks about the fact that He has many good names, many good names. Let us use these names to call Him.
وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا.
Allah says, definitely the worshipped one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has many names and qualities. Call Him using the names and qualities, because it is more important, definitely more important, to know His names and qualities than anything else. So the qualities of the Creator, as we mentioned yesterday, the concept of Godhood in Islam. Who do we worship? We don't worship a human being. We don't worship stones. We don't worship anything material. We don't worship anything created at all. We worship whoever created me and you. Whoever created us, that's who we worship. And we call him the worshipped one. Allah in the Arabic language. The worshipped one. Whoever I am going to return to and you are going to return to, whoever it is, all I know is that he is one supreme deity, one supreme being in absolute control. I call him the worshipped one, Allah, and that's whom I dedicate my whole life to. That is Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in Islam, the concept of Godhood has absolutely no risk involved. That is why when you are sick, rather than saying, Ya Allah, cure me, you are taught, O owner of cure, cure me. Whoever the owner of cure is, has heard you, and he shall cure you. That is the name of Allah, Ya Shafi Ishfini. One of the names of the worshipped one. Look at how beautiful it is. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then for example, someone who wants sustenance. O you who is the owner of sustenance, grant me sustenance. O you who can hear the call of the caller, listen to my call. Whoever is the hearer of the call has heard us. And we call him Allah, the worshipped one. What we do know about him, he is one, supreme, in absolute control, and that is whom we will worship until the day we die, and that is whom we are returning to. We will never ever worship sticks and stones, nor will we worship other human beings. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Before we actually close, I was just informed as we had started the lecture that we have had a guest or a few guests this evening from the church nearby. Alhamdulillah, you are most welcome into the masjid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all upliftment, inshallah.